Sacred Heart is proud to sponsor Pensacola Histories in recognition of the Daughters of Charity who brought their mission of care to Pensacola over 90 years ago.
Hello and welcome to our Stories of Pensacola History, in which in our first episodes we're talking about the expedition of Don Tristan de Luna y Arellano, begun in 1559. And in the course of our earlier episodes, we talk about how the expedition itself was created, how de Luna was chosen as the captain general. Following the work of the council in Madrid, they had put together a task force of 1,550 people, had landed at Pensacola or Hoyos, and then had been struck by a terrible hurricane. In the months that followed that, of course, the part of the expedition had gone into the Indian territory. They had spent a time at a little Indian village not far from Pensacola called Nanacapana. And then, of course, all had finally reassembled at Pensacola itself when the food among the Indians had run out. And now, in the latter stage of our early story, the de Luna expedition had been rescued by the arrival of six Spanish galleons led by Angel Villafañe, a former marching buddy of de Luna. Now, of course, the story was left with de Luna, who had now had left on hand here with about 50 men who were to help him begin rebuilding as the plan had originally called for, with the balance of those people had been withdrawn to Mexico. And so de Luna continued. He went on for about 6 weeks. Things were going well. He was happy with the result. And then suddenly one day a large vessel arrived. On it was the messenger coming from the viceroy and, of course, Angel Villafañe. And the word was that the viceroy and the king had changed the overall program. And as a result of this, de Luna himself and his 50 people were to be withdrawn. And that's the way it was. De Luna now was left without an opportunity to build. And he was taken first to Cuba and then to Mexico. And the story of Don Tristan de Luna from that point forward is a kind of a tragedy, because he tries to justify before the court of what had happened, and not only to justify his own reputation and his name, but perhaps to get restitution of some of the money, the funds, which his family had invested in the expedition in the beginning. They held then what was almost what Americans might have remembered as a kind of a Spanish Watergate of the 16th century. The entire trial story was put forth, and it was put forth in beautiful language. And about 80 years ago, a professor from the University of California, Professor Armstrong, went to Spain, and he got a hold of these records, and he translated them into English and put together a two-volume set, which is called the Luna Papers. And you have Spanish on one page, and the opposing page will have the English translation. So it's fairly easy to read, and it tells the entire story as related in this hearing. And when the judges finally make their decision, they say, they turn to de Luna and say, "We're sorry, but we must rule against you. We will give you no financial restitution. If you had done what you should have done and had unloaded the vessels immediately after your arrival, the chances are the results would not have been nearly as bad as they were." Well, poor de Luna, of course, he goes to his death some years later, a broken, a kind of a tragic figure. He could have been the leader of the first permanent settlement in North America. As it turned out, what he had was a loss of funds, a break in his own family, and of course, a failure of the village. Now, while all this was going on, while all the activities at Pensacola or Hoyos were in progress, the French were watching this carefully. Their secret service was watching everything that happened, because they were still determined they wanted to have a settlement here in North America to take advantage of the opportunity. Now, the head of government at that point was, of course, Catherine de' Medici, and she was approached by her prime minister, who had what he thought was a great idea. He said, "Now, we could solve two problems with one blow." He said, we would love to get some of the Huguenots out of France. They are causing all sorts of trouble for us. We don't need a religious civil war here. Why don't we do this? Why don't we offer to have the French government provide ships and all of the supplies for a colony to be placed on the eastern shore of Florida?" Well, the Queen thought that was a good idea, so they took the entire proposal to a retired admiral whose name is Gaspar Coligny, and Coligny was the head of the Huguenot movement. And Coligny went to his followers, and they agreed this was a splendid idea. So the task force was put together, and it was to be led by a soldier by the name of Jean Ribault. And Ribault, with about 250 settlers, moved west, came to about where Jacksonville is today, on the St. John's River, and they began their settlement. Well, this their settlement isn't Pensacola's story, so we'll go through just a very brief part of it to say that over the next 2 years, things did not go particularly well, but they remained in place. Ribault left, was succeeded by a man named René Ledonnier, who was not the best of leaders, but nonetheless, they survived. And then Ribault returned with further settlers, and things were going quite well. They were getting along well with the Indians. The village was growing. They built a fortress, which they called Fort Caroline. Well, as the Spanish government viewed all this through their Secret Service, the king said, well, we can have none of this. We don't want the French there. We didn't succeed at Pensacola or Hochelaga, but one of these days we are going to want this for ourselves. So the king's word to whose council was, I don't care how you do it. Don't even bother to tell me in the long run, but I want that French village gone. And so that was the order as given to the Spanish military. The man that they chose as the next leader in this story was a man who is a rather remarkable character. He would be around in Florida for some time hereafter. And his name was Don Juan Pedro Menendez de Avilés. Pedro Menendez de Avilés. Now, he was all sorts of things. He was a soldier. We might call him part pirate, part freebooter. He was tough, and he was one of these people that knows how to get results. So he put together the task force that was whose duty it was to remove the French. This group sailed west, and they landed about where St. Augustine, Florida is today. And they did so very carefully. They sent spies north very carefully, watching only at night so they wouldn't be seen, to scout out what they could see at Fort Caroline. And these men came back and said, you aren't going to believe this. There's no security. They have no guard posted. The door is left wide open at night. This is a piece of cake. So the entire force comes together. They march by night through the woods. They'd stay off the beach so they won't be spotted. And they come to the edge of the clearing where Fort Caroline is. And about 3 o'clock in the morning, they just surge in. And the result is a terrible massacre of the French. A few of them succeed in getting out into the woods, and they get away from the Spanish horses and the dogs that they have with them. And these French escapees join Indian tribes there, and we have their story because of the survivor tales that they left with the Indians. These people were never joined by other French in their time, but they did survive, and we know of what they call massacre, or the bloody place. And that was basically what it was. The French were gone. Okay, now what I'm going to tell you now really deserves a lot more detail, but this is not technically Pensacola's story, but it gives you an idea, gives the viewer an idea of how things finally came out. The remnants of the DeSoto, of the Avilés expedition marched back to St. Augustine, and they sat down, and I'm going to tell this in a form that I'm sure the St. Augustine Historical Society would not like too well, but nonetheless it gives you the idea of what really did happen. These men sat down, and they were just kind of having a good time together. They had done their job, and they were getting ready to be placed aboard ship to go home. And they're sitting around with one another and say, well, what are you going to do when you get home? Well, I don't know. My unemployment benefits are about to run out, and I understand they've just closed down the automobile works there. Our jobs are hard to find. What are you going to do? Well, I don't know. I'm in the same sort of situation. I don't know what I'd like to do when I get home, but I'm sure something. Then one of them said, you know, look around here. This place here is pretty nice. Yes, it is. Well, what do you think the captain would say if we asked if we could stay? Well, I don't know. All we can do is ask him, but I think you've got a pretty good idea. So the next morning, they got together with Menendez de Avilés and said, some of us would like to stay here and live. We don't see a future at home right now. And the captain, who was a very practical man, said, well, I can understand what you're saying. Why don't we take a vote? Those that want to stay can stay, and those who want to go home can go. So in one of the first exhibitions of Spanish democracy here in the New World, a vote was taken, and some said, yes, we would like to stay, and some said, we want to go home. And they did. And so the ones who agreed to stay formed a colony, and in very broad terms, basically that was the way St. Augustine began. It was not a grand task force. It was nothing like the De Luna expedition, but there it was, and it is still there today. Now, what lessons do we draw from all of this? Well, The Spanish had set out in 1559 to try and put a lock, a fence around North America so that the French and the English would never take root here. And of course, they failed to do that. St. Augustine was a successful colony, but it never grew to great size. And while it would be a thorn in the side of the English when English colonies began to be settled along the southern part of the Gulf of the Atlantic coast, nonetheless, it was there and had precious little that we could talk about in North American history. At Pensacola, well, the Spanish basically just sort of forgot about Pensacola. The year 1561, when De Luna was relieved, they might have said, "We put a lock on the door. We'll think about that some other time." But it would be almost 138 years before a Spanish expedition came back to Pensacola. And of course, what happened then was again the result of what the French were doing in the northeastern part of the country. Meanwhile, to bridge the story between De Luna and Avilés and the others, we have to remember that beginning in the early part of the 17th century, both the French in Canada and the English along the Atlantic coastline began to plant successful colonies here. And by the time we reached the latter part of the 1600s, the English had 12 successful colonies on the Atlantic. The Spanish had the one colony at St. Augustine. The French were very active in Canada. And basically, that's where things stood. And so we go through an entire period when particularly the French and the English parts of history change a lot. And we go through into the early part of the latter part of the 18th century. And in France, we have the era of Louis the 14th, the Sun King. And all of this puts more emphasis on what might happen in North America. And what happens next, our story of the renewal of the Hochelaga or Pensacola, or as we're going to call it in our next episode, Santa Maria de Galve, well, that all comes next. And thus we end the story of De Luna and the end of our story of Pensacola, part 5.